Morning to all. Am I audible?
Good morning, Gaurav sir. You are very much audible, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Sir, we will be waiting until 10 to begin the session, sir. And we'll wait for a few more participants.
Sure, fine.
Very, very good morning to you, sir. Thank you. A very good morning to all of you. Welcome to the fourth day of recent advances and real-time applications in Artificial Intelligence Faculty Development Program. I'm sure you would have enjoyed and have been empowered with knowledge in Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning, and now you are already understanding what deep learning is. Today's day is more about having application-oriented knowledge and wisdom about these. Amidst us is a personality who's a computer science postgraduate and also holds up a degree in law. It's Dr. Gaurav Agarwal, who's the founder and director and promoter of Magma Research and Consultancy Services, Ambala, Haryana, India. Sir is an MCA, MPhil, MTech, and a computer science person in computer science, and holds a law degree LLB. He is also an IBM certified associate developer. Sir possesses about 20 years experience in teaching, industry, and research, and has published papers on assorted technologies as main author in many international magazines, journals, newspapers, and conferences, and is associated with a number of international periodicals as editor, reviewer, member of advisory panel, and holds international certifications in data science, Python, blockchain programming, machine learning, software testing, quantum computing, and related technologies from corporate and academic organizations including IBM, Google, TCS, Accenture, IITs, Udemy, UpGrad, and many more. Sir delivers practical hands-on sessions on recent technologies in workshops, faculty development programs, short-term training courses, webinars, and technical events as resource persons in various states in India. Sir has been associated as jury and evaluator in different national level competitions and events under the aegis of Government of India. And we are fortunate to have him as the resource person for this day. During today's session, Sir shall throw insights on using Python for deep learning. Sir's talk would cover how Python could be used in deep learning, how we could do image processing, or how we could handle the image data and perform pre-processing using Python, and how object and face recognition are implemented, and how models are trained. So this is what we have, a very action-packed day. I welcome Sir to this FPP. And I
Good morning,
everybody
sir.
To participate. Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Is
Have
it
a very
audible, sir?
Awesome day. Yes, sir. You are very much audible, sir. Thank you so much. Over to you, sir. Gaurav, sir, over to you. Dr. Gaurav, are you with us, sir? Gaurav, sir, are you with us? Sir, we couldn't hear you. Gaurav, sir? Yes, sir. There is some noise that is from your end. Thank you, sir.
Good morning to all. Am I audible? Dear all, kindly confirm. Am I audible
yes,
to?
Sir. Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Okay, there was some bandwidth issue, so it was disconnected. So should we start the session, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfectly. Over to you, sir. Thank you so much. And
Thank
welcome
you,
once again.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all of the participants and organizing committee of this event. We are starting this session. Dear all, kindly confirm, is it audible and visible to all of you? In chat, kindly respond, is it audible and visible to all participants? I have shared the presentation. Okay, so in this session, we will cover different implementation perspectives of deep learning, convolutional neural networks using Python-based platforms, including Keras, TensorFlow, PyTorch, OpenCV. So you will see most of the coverage will be in practical demonstration mode. But before covering any point with practical demonstration or hands-on, first of all, we should be clear about layered approach, what is basically steps, which are different steps involved in implementation of deep learning or image processing, facial expression recognition, whether you are working in image data analytics, video data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, or any advanced model of artificial intelligence. First of all, we should be clear about how to do it. What is a phase for beginners as well as for intermediate level researchers? As you can see in this slide, CPU, GPU, TPU, we must be clear about this point, because when we work on TensorFlow and we work on Keras, then we need specialized hardware. We need specialized platforms for implementation of deep learning. Okay, so first of all, we will see which are steps involved in deep learning implementations. After that, we will see how to implement it on different cloud-based platforms or on your own laptop. As you can see in this slide, first step, whenever we work in machine learning or deep learning or data science-based project, You might have seen many times we get good results. We are having a particular effective algorithm along with that data set, but we struck at a specific accuracy level. In whatever domain you are doing research, in whatever algorithm you are working, our accuracy should be above 90%. In case of deep learning, we move ahead to 99% or 99.99%. So how to work on some implementations in which we can achieve highest level of accuracy? So first point that is majorly important, that is very, very important, is benchmark data set. We must use benchmark data set. Many times researchers use deep learning for medical images, for ultrasound images, CT scan, X-ray, or geospatial images. And they collect their own data from some hospitals, from some labs. In case of academic domain, in case of academic degree, self-collected data is not acceptable in general. In most of the times, self-collected data is not appropriate for academic degrees. What is academic degree? ME, MTech, PhD. For to gain an academic credential, we must be having benchmark data set. So I will show you some sources of benchmark data sets. For example, you are working in dengue disease or COVID, or you need some particular data set from Instagram, from Facebook, from DRDO, from NASA. So we should be knowing that what is the source of data. After that, we work on deep learning or machine learning. If our data set is not appropriate, then nobody can save us. Accuracy will be very, very low. It will be compromised. And moreover, that work will not be acceptable. Okay. So first point, that for academic degree, for academic credential, we must be having benchmark data set. After that, we perform some implementation. And second point, deep learning unit, which deep learning unit we need, whether GPU or TPU. How many participants are aware with GPU and TPU in deep learning? I will show its implementation also. What is difference between GPU and TPU? If I'm working on Keras, Python, whether I should activate GPU or TPU? Any random guess? If you can write in chat, I'm watching chat messages in parallel. Which technology, which hardware I should use for Keras? GPU or TPU? No idea. Okay, so we cover it very quickly. Listen, please note down this very carefully, that GPU is a general purpose graphics processing unit, which we call as graphic card. You might have seen many students play video games, 3D video games, high resolution video games. For that, we use graphic card. You might have seen in many laptops, there is a sticker, NVIDIA graphic card, NVIDIA GPU. So it is a general purpose graphic card, general purpose graphics processing unit, which we can use for deep learning, no issue. It is fine, okay? For TensorFlow, for Keras, for Python. But what is TPU? TPU is a specialized processor that is developed by Google to enhance the power of GPU, to enhance the powers which we implement in TensorFlow. So TPU is a tensor processing unit. So this point should be noted very carefully. If you are using TensorFlow, if you are using Keras platform for deep learning, we should use a TPU. TPU is 3 times faster than GPU because it is a specialized, customized processor for TensorFlow. So GPU is product of NVIDIA. TPU is product of Google. TensorFlow is also product of Google. So to give push to the implementation, TPU is developed. Okay, so we can use it. We should use TPU for TensorFlow Keras. If you are using PyTorch or OpenCV, then you can use GPU. Okay, no issue. Is this point clear to all of you? Kindly write in chat. What is major difference between TPU and GPU, and which we should use? Okay. Next point. So first point is benchmark data set. Second point, deep learning unit. We for TensorFlow we will use TPU for general purpose image processing, video processing, data science, we use GPU. After that, we select programming platform, whether I should take Python or we should use Ruby on Rails or I should use Java for implementation of high performance deep learning implementations. We use Python. Okay. And after that, we have to select whether we should implement CNN or RNN or GRU or LSTM, because it is also very, very important. For example, I'm having image data. And on that image data, if I try to implement RNN, in that case, my results may be compromised. My results may be very, very bad. If I'm having data of audio, data of speech, and on that, if I will try to implement CNN, in that case also, I will get very bad results. So we must know whether we should use RNN, whether we should use CNN, convolutional neural network, or LSTM, long short-term memory. So these terms, we must be clear. So very quickly, we will discuss it, where we should use which network model. After that, we will implement it. Okay. As far as implementation, running of code is concerned, it is not a big job. Every source code is available on GitHub, on open source platforms, on cloud. Anybody can take and you can run it. But until and unless we don't know about the concept, implementation is of no use. Many times you might have seen that scholars take some data from here and there. They take some source code from GitHub and we feel very happy by viewing that running of code, by viewing that output. But when the task comes on changing that code, in that case, it becomes very difficult because they don't know where to use LSTM, where to use GRU, where to use traditional dense network, where to use convolutional 1D network. If we are aware with each and everything in simple language, then you can do anything in deep learning. So very quickly, I will cover it in very simple way in using simple example. If we are having image data set, then we should use CNN, convolutional neural networks. If we are having audio data, time series data, speech data, sentiment data of Facebook, Twitter, then we should use RNN. So RNN is suitable, recurrent neural network is suitable only for time series based data. If we are having, for example, if we are having images related to time series, for example, geospatial images from last 5 years, we are collecting per second data set we have collected of images, then we should use RNN. If random images we are having, then we must use CNN. If we are having a particular audio data, as I am delivering a session, okay, for example, my audio is getting recorded. So this is time series data. At 10 a.m. we have started up to 1 p.m. Okay, so this is 3 hours data. We must use RNN, LSTM, that is time series, because in different time spans we have collected the data. If audio data is there, but not in time series way, it is collected randomly, then we can use CNN. Okay, if we are having CSV data, XML data, traditional text data, Excel sheet data, then we should use CNN. If Excel sheet data, CSV data is in time series mode, then we should use RNN. For example, now I'm asking you one question, just to get about you, just to know about you, how much you you have, how much it is clear to all of you what is RNN and CNN. Okay. For example, I'm having data of stock market, data of a particular share of last 1 year. I want to predict upcoming value of that share. Which algorithm I should use, CNN or RNN? I'm having last 1 year data about a share, about Nifty or stock market. I want to predict upcoming value, CNN or RNN? Write in chat. One answer is RNN. Any other response? I'm having sequential data, I'm having historical data of something, share market or rainfall, and I want to predict upcoming. Yes, this is 100% correct, RNN, because historical data means time series data. In different time spans, we have collected data and then we are predicting upcoming thing. Now, again, now second question. I'm having some X-ray images of a particular patient, which are collected from last 5 months in sequence. And I want to predict after how much time this person will be COVID positive or negative, or after how much time it will be dengue positive or negative by viewing historical X-ray images, CNN or RNN, which we should use. Again, RNN, 100% correct, because sequential X-ray images, if X-ray images are haphazard, if X-ray images are randomly taken, then we should use CNN. Is this point clear to all of you? Where to use which model? Is it clear to all participants? Kindly confirm in chat. Okay, so first of all, we are covering the concepts in very easy way, then we will go for its implementation part. Okay. Now, after that, after selection of model, after selection of network type, we check, okay, whether we should use pre-trained model or custom model. Pre-trained model means those models which are created by so many corporate giants. Thousands of models are already available on internet. Okay, so I am showing you that portal, bookingface.co and modelzoo.co. Okay. Is it visible to all of you? Is this page visible to all participants? Bookingface.co. This portal is having thousands of pre-trained models which are given, which are delivered by corporate giants. You can see that, for example, I want to use that algorithm which Google is using for its Google search. I want to use that algorithm which Facebook is using, which WhatsApp is using at backend. I want to use algorithm of Grammarly. Okay, so you can see that all of these are available in free distribution for researchers. You can take any of these pre-trained models. These are pre-trained models. Okay, I will show you its implementation also, how to use it in Google Colab or in your system. Okay, and this is modelzoo.co. Thousands of pre-trained models. Pre-trained model means, for example, I'm working on a drone application. I have taken some grant fund for a particular project, and I want to create a drone or robot with computer vision. In that particular drone or in that robot, what I need, I want that it should identify each and every person in front of it. That drone should not collide with buildings. Self-driven robots, self-driven automated drones. But it is possible only if I train, only if I give each and every image to that drone. Okay, if images of different types of vehicles, different types of creatures are not available in drone, in that case it will collide with them. So to avoid collision of robot, we will have to give images to that robot, that this is the trained model, and you will have to match. If this type of object is coming, then turn left or turn right or stop. But how it is possible that millions of images we train in a robot, from where we will get all images of car, buses, animals, creatures, insects, human beings, buildings, trees? It is not possible to take millions of images and training a particular drone or robot. For that, we use pre-trained models. Okay, so many pre-trained models are available. For example, I want to work on Google Map. Okay, so Deep OSM. So you can see train TensorFlow neural networks with OpenStreetMap satellite imagery. It is having the complete data set of Google Images and OpenStreetMap. No need to deploy your own satellite, because it is very difficult. How it is possible that we are having images of each and every city, each and every street, each and every location, each and every river? For that, we can take this type of pre-trained model. Okay. To this point, is it clear to all of you? Kindly confirm in chat. Are you getting what we are discussing here? Is this point clear up to this up to now? And as far as the speed is concerned, is it okay? Communication speed, is it okay to all of you? Are you getting? Okay. Now we will see some benchmark sources of data for research and development. So all of these links I have shared in this presentation. At end of this session, I will give this presentation to all of you so that you can follow it. So you can see that. So some portals I am opening here directly. After that, so this is the website for pre-trained models. Okay, for face recognition, pre-trained models, modelzoo.co. I will show you that. So for example, face. Okay, so NIMGAN coupled face generation. Okay, so all of these pre-trained models are for face recognition. I will cover it in practical session also. Okay, in afternoon I'm having one session on face recognition. In that I will give you a detailed demonstration of face analytics. I will show my own images. I will use my own webcam so that you can visualize each and everything, how to work on that. Okay, for emotions, emotion detection also I will cover in this session, that is for face recognition. Okay, is it visible to all of you? So you can see that face attention network. Is it visible to all? So for face, different pre-trained models available. VGG, face, CNN descriptor. Okay, so IEEE data port. This is very good source of benchmark data sets. So I'm opening this site, and these are different links. If you are working in malware fingerprints, Android data sets, if you need to take. Okay, so you can see this IEEE data port. And no need to take IEEE subscription. Many times we think that it is IEEE data port, so we need IEEE subscription. No need of any IEEE subscription. Simply create free account on this portal and you will be able to work on multiple data sets. So you can see that. But for image processing, for IoT, for COVID-19 also. So you can see fractures in UAV imagery for segmentation, video aesthetics. Okay. Indian road scenarios. If you are working in road analytics or geospatial data sets. If you are interested in sentiment data analysis, then Twitter data. Twitter data, Facebook data, Instagram data, these will be available. Okay, so and COVID-19 data sets. news about news and tweets on COVID-19 related to multiple countries. If you are working in biomedical images, CT scan images of COVID-19 patients, these are available. Chest X-ray images. So all of these are freely available. Lung images. Is it visible to all? You can take any of these data set for your research. Okay. Simply, you can see that all of these zip files are available. We can download it. Okay. Is it clear to all? Kindly confirm. Up to this point, is it clear? To all of you, so the links I have put in this presentation, which I will share at end of this session. IEEE data port. Now another source. Now we will see how to work on deep learning based scenarios. For data sets, Kaggle is also a prominent source, Kaggle data sets. So I'm opening it, and within Kaggle itself, we can work in deep learning. Okay, so this link I have shared here. Is it visible to all of you? Is it visible to all participants? Kindly confirm. Okay, so you can see this Kaggle data sets.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you can see this Kaggle data sets. Okay, now Kaggle, how many of you are aware with Kaggle kernels for deep learning? Kaggle kernels for deep learning. Are you aware with the Kaggle kernels? So many data sets available. What is Kaggle kernels? So similar to Google Colab, we can work with deep learning in Kaggle kernels. So you can see here in Kaggle.com, we click on code. And what is major benefit of using Kaggle kernel as compared to Google Colab? Okay, for deep learning, either you can use Google Colab or Kaggle kernels. But what is additional advantage of using Kaggle kernel? First of all, Kaggle provides you 100 GB space. 100 GB web space is provided by Kaggle. So you can see here on click of new notebook. And along with 100 GB web space in Kaggle kernel, you are provided additional programming platform of R. So you can see that in which language you want to work with, Python or R. In case of Google Colab, we are provided Python platform. In case of Kaggle kernels, you can work with R also. Okay, now you can see which accelerator I need, GPU or TPU? GPU for traditional image processing, for traditional video processing. If I am working on TensorFlow Keras, then I should activate TPU. Okay. And another benefit of using Kaggle kernel is that Kaggle provides you 30 hours of TPU and GPU, 30 hours. Google Colab provides you 24 hours. After 24 hours, it is refreshed. Okay. And web space, very huge. So you can see here how much RAM you are getting and how much disk space we are able to work with. Now, another benefit of using Kaggle, there is no need to upload any data set. If data set is available on Kaggle, we can attach GBs of data set in a single click. No need to download. For example, I'm having 5 GB data set of X-ray images. So first of all, what I will do, I will download 5 GB data. Then I will upload 5 GB on my platform. No need to do that. Simply, you can see here at top right, add data. On click of this, which data I need to work with? For example, X-ray, COVID-19 chest X-ray images, heart attack analysis prediction. For example, I need this data. This data is of 240 MB. You can see this 240.9 MB. In a single click, this data will be added with my Python. So you can see that. No need to download 240 MB, 250 MB. No need to upload 250 MB. Okay, because in downloading and uploading, your 500 GB, your 500 MB data will be lost. Okay, and these are the files. For example, I need to use this file in my Python code. Click here. Okay, so this is the path. Copy and simply put your input file here. If I need to work with any other file, for example, this file, this is the path. Copy. It is providing a complete path. Paste. Now this data set is workable, is easy to use. If I need to add another data, add data. For example, MRI. So brain MRI data, click. So it is, you can see around 1 GB data, 713 MB data. No need to download it and again upload. Click, add data. You will see in Kaggle kernel, this data set will be available. MRI, COVID chest X-ray images. Okay. So by this way, we will be able to work very easily. So you can see that in few seconds, we have attached 1.3 GB data without downloading and uploading. Otherwise, it takes lots of time. First of all, we download data, then we upload data, then our net speed is affected. Our data, whatever we are getting, it is also affected. Okay. Is this point clear to all of you? How to use Kaggle kernels for our implementations? Is it clear to all? Kindly confirm in chat. And are you getting all of these points clearly? Whatever we have covered so far. Okay, so it's up to your wish whether you want to use Kaggle kernels or you want to use Google Colab. Now, we will see how to work on this. So these are different sources of data sets, UCI machine learning repository, and these are some points. So these screenshots I have put in this presentation, which I will give to all of you. Okay, Kaggle kernel, GPU and TPU. And by this way, we can activate any platform. So I will share this PPT to all of you. So you can see that private data, 100 GB in Kaggle kernels. And now we are starting the implementation part. We are starting with the execution part. Before execution, so I'm putting my presentation in this way so that in parallel I can communicate with you. Okay, so this chat window I have opened in parallel. Is this visible to all of you? Because by this way, I can interact with you. Is this slide visible clearly to all? Okay, so I have put it in this way rather than full screen so that I can read your messages also for interaction. Okay. Now what we will do? Now we will perform implementation, and for implementation, I am using a particular data set. So this is the data set. Okay, this data set we will use here it is related to some body parameters. These are body parameters of one patient, and one means that person is positive with that disease. If body parameters of second patients are these, then zero. So this is class level, class or label or target. These are inputs. On the basis of inputs, we are matching, we are linking the class label. Okay, now this is the training data. There are thousands of records in this particular data set. Okay, now if I want to predict upcoming patient, so this is my test data. In this test data, you can see that final label is missing. This is missing. This I want to predict. I want to predict whether it will be 0 or 1, whether it will be 0 or 1 on the basis of this training. So this is my training data at upper layer. Okay, this is test data and this training data. Okay, so in this way, so that we can see both. This is test data and this is training data. Is it visible to all of you? On basis of this training, we will predict what will happen to this person, whether it will be 0 or 1, whether this will be 0 or 1. Training data, testing data. Okay, this data set is related to body parameters, human body parameters, and we know that if this is the combination, then this person is negative, disease negative. If this is the combination of body parameters, whether it is BP level, diabetic or heart disease, then that particular person is positive. Okay, on basis of the model that we will create using this data, we will predict what will happen to these 8 patients. These are upcoming patients. This is the testing data. Is this data set clear to all of you? What we are doing, is it clear to all participants? Kindly write in chat. We will train this data in our model and we will predict this particular data set. Now, what we will do? To implement deep learning or machine learning or predictive analysis, one approach, we must be very, very clear what is activation function or transfer function. So I will not cover it in so much theoretical points, so many theoretical descriptions. I will cover it very quickly so that you come to know. Okay. If my output type is binary, 0 or 1, yes or no, true or false, then I will use a particular activation function. Okay, so I'm skipping these points. So which activation function we should use? If my output is binary, then I will use sigmoid activation function. If I want to predict whether this person will die or not, sigmoid. So activation function decides the type of output, what I want to predict. And it is discrete in nature. It is fixed, 0 or 1, true or false, yes or no, enabled or disabled. If I want to predict whether it will be rainfall or not, 0 or 1, sigmoid activation function in my deep learning program. If I want to predict whether this person is COVID positive or negative, sigmoid. If I want to predict probability, how much probability is there that this is COVID positive? 77%, it may be 72.9%. In that case, I will not use sigmoid. I will use 10H or any other activation function. So this is very important. So in this particular data set, if I want to predict only yes or no, only 0 or 1, then sigmoid. In same way, if we are having CT scan images, MRI images, I want to predict whether this person is having cancer or not. whether this person is having dengue or not, sigmoid. If I want to predict probability, how much probability is there? How much probability is there for rainfall? How much probability of tsunami? How much probability of third wave for that 10H? If I want to predict whether a third wave will come or not, sigmoid. Okay, so for this data set, we will use sigmoid. Are you getting audio clearly? Are you getting audio clearly? Kindly confirm, as one message is there.
Sir, it's clear, sir.
So, when not to use sigmoid, if we want to predict probability, if we want to predict the actual value, for prediction of actual value, we use 10H or any other activation function. Okay, softmax is also there. So this point should be clear. And ReLU, what is ReLU activation function? This is also very important. Whenever we work with deep learning or machine learning implementation, we must use ReLU activation function along with sigmoid or any other. Why we should use it? If we do not use ReLU, that is rectified linear unit, then we can be struck at a particular accuracy level. For example, in 10 iterations, what is my error factor? This is error factor 0.0000, so many 0 and then 43. In 1000 iterations, I am not coming out of so many zeros, only this value is optimized. Okay, in 1 million iterations, only this. Okay, or in 1 trillion iterations, even I am at this level. I want to come out of this, I want to make it 0, I want to make it 1. So ReLU gives us big jump. Otherwise, what happens? So I'm opening Notepad. For example, first of all, I'm getting 98 point, this much accuracy. Then in 100 iterations, in 1000 iterations, I'm getting 98.982, this much accuracy. In 1 lakh iterations or 1 trillion iterations, I'm getting 98.99, this much accuracy. So it is very time consuming. Only I'm not able to come out from this. I want 99% accuracy. I want to round off this value. To round off, I will implement ReLU. So ReLU will give me big jump and it will push me directly to 99 point something. Is it clear to all? Why we should use ReLU activation function? It reduces gradient descent problem. This is known as gradient descent problem. Okay, is it clear to all why we should use ReLU activation function? Kindly confirm. What is role of ReLU activation function? So I have mentioned it in presentation also. Now we will start. We will see an implementation Keras TensorFlow. So up to now we have cleared the concepts. Okay, clearing what is ReLU. Otherwise, what happens? We don't know about ReLU. What is softmax? What is 10H? And we directly take source code and we run, and we feel very happy that my code is running. So everybody's code get run if we are taking it from good source. Okay, but we should be knowing where to change the code, how to improve accuracy. So now we will work on Keras TensorFlow. We will solve that problem. Now see this presentation, and I'm directly opening Google Colab, in which we will solve this research problem. Okay, this is the input data, this is a target, and on basis of this we will predict some value. Okay, so I'm opening it in Google Colab. so that we can see it. Is it visible to all of you? Is it visible to all participants? Kindly confirm. So this data set we will use. Okay. Now, to upload any data set, so I'm having this data set. So obviously on Google Colab, I will have to upload it so that I can train our neural network. I can train a deep learning based network. Okay. To upload any file in Google Colab, we use these two lines. From google.colab import files and then files.upload. My data set will be uploaded. Next point. From keras.models import sequential. This is very important. Now, first of all, we should be clear what is relation of Keras and TensorFlow. Keras is the upper layer of TensorFlow. Whatever we do in TensorFlow in 1000 lines of code, same thing can be done in Keras in 2 lines of code. I'm repeating this point. For example, some implementation I want to do in TensorFlow, because TensorFlow is a broad platform, broad framework. If something is implementable in TensorFlow in 10,000 lines of code of Python, same implementation in Keras can be done in 3 to 4 lines of code. Why? Because Keras is the upper layer on TensorFlow. It removes the complexity of TensorFlow. Okay. For example, I want to work on image analytics, video analytics. Rather than using base TensorFlow, we use Keras. Okay, so you can see that from keras.models import sequential. In single line, we have imported sequential model. But if you will try to create a sequential model in TensorFlow, you will have to write at least 500 lines of code. But Keras is giving you upper layer. So you can say that Keras is providing APIs. Okay, functions. Keras is providing you APIs. Okay, dense. From Keras to layers, dense. What is dense? In case of, actually what happens, so there's one query, so we can skip TensorFlow instead of Keras. Okay, actually what happens whenever we run Keras, automatically at backend TensorFlow is executed. So without TensorFlow, we can't run Keras. Are you understanding this point? Without using TensorFlow, we can't run Keras, because whatever we run in Keras, automatically it is linked with backend TensorFlow. Got it? Okay. Whatever you will do in Keras, automatically it will fetch related libraries from TensorFlow. When you will run this code in Google Colab or Kaggle kernels, you will see that it will be written running TensorFlow at backend. Okay, we are working on Keras, but automatically it will be written in execution that TensorFlow at backend is running. So without TensorFlow, we can't work on Keras. Okay, so dense network. From keras.layers import dense. What is dense? This is dense. Every node is connected to each other. This is known as a dense network. You might have seen so many diagrams of deep learning. So most of the diagrams of deep learning are like this, in which every node is connected to each other. All hidden layers are interconnected. This is known as fully connected dense deep learning model. Okay, so why sequential? Because we are moving from input to output. So this is input to output. In a sequence, we are moving, but in fully connected way. Okay, that's why we use dense network. After that, we must take either dropout or random seed. Either you can use dropout or you can use random seed or and any integer. This integer can be any, it can be 17, it can be 9999, any integer you can take. Okay, 17, 7, there is no hard and fast rule. Why we should use random seed? In this data set, if I am training a model, using this data set, if I am training a model, I am training a deep learning model, then entire data set is never given to the model in one shot. Entire data set is not provided to that model for training. Randomly records are fetched. For example, randomly these records are fetched and it will be given to training. It will be given to that model. After that, these random records will be taken. So we specify in code also what is the batch size. This is known as batch size. So you can see here, batch size 10. If my batch size is 10, it means my source code, my execution program will take randomly 10 records and it will be given for training. Then again, randomly 10 records. Now, what is the role of this random seed? Random seed act as a pointer. You can give entire data set, but in that case, its fitting will be very, very bad. Its training will be very, very bad. Accuracy will be very bad. Okay, so we have to give data in chunks. So now if I ask you one question, okay, for example, I have a particular, I want to learn a particular story. That particular story is of 10 pages. So is it possible for me to learn 10 pages in one shot? I want to learn one theorem of 5 pages in single shot. Is it possible for anybody? It is not possible. So what we do? We break that problem, divide and conquer. We break that particular part. Okay. First of all, first paragraph. So for 2 days, we keep on learning only two paragraphs. After that, then one paragraph. And in multiple iterations, that is also batch. So human being, human brain also use deep learning, also use batches. So we also can't learn anything in single shot. We have, so now we are coming again to that point. If I do not use random seed, then my model will suffer from a particular term that is known as overfitting. Overfitting without randomization. If I do not use randomization or random seed, my model will be overfit, and overfit model will be very, very bad in prediction. What is overfitting? For example, I have not given this. For example, I have put a comment here. I am not using any random seed. In that case, what problem can happen? For example, randomly these 10 records are taken. It will be given to that model for training. Again, same 10 records can be taken. So my program will not remember which records are already trained. So it may keep on giving same set of records again and again. And if only these 10 records are given 100 times, then prediction will be on the basis of only these 10 records. This is known as overfitting. Rather than taking entire data set in random way, same 5, 6 or 10 records are fit 100 times. And this is known as overfitting, and prediction of entire data. Yes, definitely. It will keep track of the chunk done and which left. It will keep track of the chunk. So next time it will not take it. Next time it will take this. Then it will take this. Okay, then it will take randomly this. So random combinations will be taken. So random seed work as a pointer. In C language, you might have worked on pointers. So it keep track of the records, it keep track of the memory locations. Okay, either you can use dropout. Dropout means 25% dropout, or 30% dropout, or 20% dropout. It means randomly it will drop 25% records from entire data set, and remaining 75% records will be trained. Then again, it will drop 25% records randomly, then it will be trained. This is known as reproducibility, avoidance of overfitting. Is this clear to all of you? What is role of random seed and dropout? Up to this point, is it clear to all? Kindly confirm in chat. So sequential model, and after that dropout. Now we will train this data. So you can see this scores.csv. This is the CSV file which we will upload. Okay. In this, this is X. This is X. First 8 records are X, and this is Y. Okay. So we have put it, and now this is the network formation. This is deep learning network formation. Model is equal to sequential. Input dimensions 8. These 8 dimensions. These are inputs. And activation function ReLU, but final prediction is in form of 0 or 1 sigmoid. And this is the shape of network 12841. Many times this question is asked by participants, why not we have taken 16, why not we have taken this, okay, why we have taken 12 4 4, why we can't skip this. Depending upon the size of data set, you can modify. This first layer, this first number should be greater than or equal to input dimension. It can be 10 also. It can be 9 also. It can be 16 also. Okay. So just 12 we have taken. Then 8. Then 4. So it is for load balancing. So this type. I'm creating its diagram. So for example, I'm taking 12841 in this way. For example, these are 12. Okay, then 8. For example, this. Then, so this is the shape, this type of load balancing will be done. It means data will move in this way. This type of dense network will be created. Okay, so in this way, the final output is in 0 or 1 here, 0 or 1. So you can skip any intermediate phase also. If you don't, if my data set is having millions of records, then 12 is not sufficient. Then I will have to start from 120, then 60, so that load balancing will be done properly. Otherwise, if I'm taking only this part, for example, only this I have taken, in that case, my model will be fit with very bad accuracy because there is no load balancing. Processor will not be able to handle this much load in only single layer. Okay, so we have to use in this way. ReLU, sigmoid, finally 0 and 1. Is it clear to all of you? What is the meaning of this network shape? Kindly confirm, is it clear to all? So there is no hard and fast rule. You can create your own network shape depending upon problem. If you are working on X-ray images, MRI images, its shape will be different. After that, we compile this model with some optimizers. Optimizer means this is the mathematical approach for compilation. Not only ADAM, we are having NADAM, ADAMX, so many other. So Keras optimizers. So you can see this. In Keras optimizers, you will get so many optimizers. if you are new in deep learning, you can write very good research papers. So in one implementation, write Adam. In second implementation, simply use NADM and run it. Then you can use AdaMax. And after that, you will see the difference of results. So these are optimizers, NADM, AdaMax. So you can work on comparative evaluation of different optimizers. So reading, what is execution time of SGD? What is execution time of Adam? And note down it in Excel sheet and plot. It will be your empirical research paper with comparative evaluation. So this is official website of Keras. Okay, and you can see that why we were saying that without TensorFlow we can't work with Keras. You can see that from TensorFlow import Keras. Keras is a component of TensorFlow, which avoid complexity of base platform. Okay, and after that we upload the test data set. And what is epoch size? Epoch is 50. In 50 iterations it will be run. Batch size is 10. Okay, now I will run it. So you can see that first of all I will upload training data. So where is my training data? So I'm writing it here. So this is scores.csv. In 50 epochs, this code will be executed. And after that, we will get testing data. We will upload testing data. We will check accuracy of this model also, how much it is accurate. In 50 epochs, 10 batch size. And you can see that how much it is giving accuracy, 74.09%. And execution time is 23 seconds. Now I want to predict test data. In test data, I'm having 8 records. We will check whether we are getting 8 predictions or not. So you can see this. This is the prediction. So first will be 1, second is 0. So it will be 1, it will be 0, third is 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. So this is the prediction depending upon that training. So 8 predictions we have obtained. Okay. And with how much accuracy? With this much, 74.09 accuracy. If I want to see same thing in 100 epochs, if I want to check in 100 epochs or 70 epochs, batch size is 40. Then we will see whether accuracy will be increased or decreased. So first of all, scores. And is it visible to all participants? Kindly confirm. Increasing epochs and updation of batch size. Now accuracy is increased to some level. Earlier it was 74.09. Now it is 74.35% test data. And in 11.03 seconds, it is executed. And this is the output prediction, 8 predictions. Is it visible to all participants? Kindly confirm in chat. And you can see that in only 20 to 25 lines of code. How much is looking difficult or easy? How much it is looking easy or difficult to work with? So what we have done, we have uploaded training data. We have created a shape of a network and we are predicting test data. This. Now, so this source code is given here in this presentation also. In this PPT, I have put this source code which you can use in your system. In this, any question up to this point, any query, anything if you want to ask. And are you understanding each and everything, or it is looking difficult? Activation. Activation function means it will decide the type of output. You can see that this is activation function, sigmoid or ReLU or ReLU. Okay, it will decide the format of output, whether output is in 0 and 1. If I will put 10H, then I will not get output in 0 and 1. I will get output in real numbers, 0.725, 0.926, in this way. Up to this point, is it clear to all of you? Kindly confirm. Okay, now one question I will ask you. Okay, you can see that we are at 76.9% accuracy in this presentation, and in this demonstration we are getting 74.35% accuracy. If I want to increase its accuracy, then we can use some specialized methods, that is ensemble learning. Ensemble learning is one of the very powerful technique to increase accuracy. For example, I am striking at 76% accuracy, 78% accuracy. With ensemble learning, we can elevate that accuracy level. Ensemble learning means hybrid learning. It is also known as cocktail learning. How many of you are aware with ensemble learning or cocktail learning? Kindly confirm, kindly write in chat so that I come to know whether this is clear or not. How many of you are aware with ensemble or cocktail learning? If you don't know, you can write don't know, no issue. In case of ensemble learning or cocktail deep learning or hybrid ensemble learning, we merge multiple models. We merge multiple techniques. You can see that in this presentation, okay, in this slide. You might have seen when we listen some music, if at background of that music composition only single an instrument is running, then it may not be melodious. It may or may not be melodious. But you might have seen in a melodious music composition, there are hundreds of musical instruments which run at background, which are played at background. Guitar, harmonium, violin, so many instruments. That is known as ensemble of instruments. Same thing we use in deep learning, in artificial intelligence. Rather than using single algorithm, if I use 5 to 6 algorithms in parallel, at backend, random forest approach, support vector classifier, logistic regression, if I use multiple algorithms at backend in parallel, then it is known as ensemble deep learning or ensembled artificial intelligence approach or cocktail machine learning. So this term I have not created, it is available already, cocktail machine learning. So many research papers are available on this topic, cocktail ensemble. It means merger of different techniques to get better accuracy. In case of sensitive applications like medical domain, like space exploration, there is no scarcity of supercomputers. We are having supercomputers. Okay, we are having very good hardware, very good software. So we should not be worried about that. If we will use 5 to 6 algorithms, then time execution time will increase. Definitely execution time will increase in if we will execute multiple algorithms at background. Okay, if we will use multiple algorithms at background, then execution time will increase. But if we are having supercomputers, If we are having good hardware, then there is no issue of execution time. For space exploration, for medical data, for medical data analysis, for medical robotics, we should use ensemble learning. In that, we merge different techniques. We merge multiple models, okay, in this way. So I'm showing you this code also. This is the code of ensembled deep learning. Ensemble deep learning with multiple layers. So in traditional, what we have done, this is only one layer, one sequential. Now in ensembled model, if I need to increase its accuracy, if I need to fine tune this model, now you can see that this is first layer. This is second layer. Okay. So rather than single sequential model, rather than single layer, we can use multiple layers and then we can have 80% accuracy. This is known as fine tuning. So ensembled means fine tuning of models. Okay. It is not a manipulation of accuracy. It is not manipulation of algorithms. It is related to tuning, tuning of model. Are you getting what I mean to say with ensemble learning? Is this point clear to all of you? What is ensemble deep learning and ensemble machine learning? In ensemble machine learning, we use multiple algorithms at backend, like random forest, support vector classifier, naive bayes, and KNN algorithm, Gaussian algorithm, multiple algorithms we can use at background, which will push the tuning factor of that model. Is it clear to all participants? I will share this presentation and this code to all of you. Up to this point, is it clear to all? Kindly confirm. Any query from participants about this part? Up to now, whatever we have discussed, any query from participants? Meanwhile, I'm sharing its present. I'm sharing source code and presentations to all of you. If you have any query, if you want to ask any point, you can unmute. This point, whatever we have covered, any query from participants, kindly confirm. You can unmute or you can write in chat. Meanwhile, I am sharing these study materials. For this presentation, source code and data sets I am uploading. And it will be shared to all of you. If you want to discuss anything, if you have any query, you can unmute or you can write in chat. Dear participants, presentation code and data set I have shared in chat. In chat, link is shared. Click on this link and you can download presentation code and data set, which we have used in this session. Please confirm, are you able to download it or not? Is it downloadable or not? Dear participants, link of the presentation, data set and code is shared in chat. Please confirm, is it downloadable? Are you able to download this? Okay, and any query, any doubt, if you want to ask any query from participants, whatever we have covered in this session. Any query? My mail detail is given in presentation itself. In last slide of this presentation, you will get mail details. Okay. And how much it is looking easy or difficult to work with? How much it is looking easy or difficult to work? Any query from participants in this session, whatever we have covered, and after that we will have a break, and then in next session we will discuss some more points.
Yes. Participants, any queries you can ask, sir, so that we can begin the next session at 11:45.
No queries.
Sir, I think no queries. Sir, we'll take a break, sir.
Yes, ma'am, sure. We can have a break.
Yeah, we'll continue the session from 11:45. Okay, sir. Participants attendance link will be shared
okay,
to you.
Thank you, ma'am. So at 11:45, we'll meet again.
Yes.
With some more fun.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, attendance link will be shared now. Please post your attendance. It will be closed by 11:45.
Engineering is redefining life, and crafting engineers is a social commitment. It requires a world of technostructure, where masterminds guide the graduates towards perfection, and incredible imaginations transform into inventions. Wagdevi Engineering Colleges, dream companies, dream placements, dream packages. Bollikunta, Warangal. Industry-centric curriculum, flexible choice-based credit system, exceptional mentoring by the expert teachers, on-campus incubation center, inculcating innovative approach, strong industrial alliances, and sustaining record of placements. Wagdevi Engineering Colleges, dream companies, dream placements, dream packages. Mollikunta, Warangal.
వాగ్దేవి ఇంజనీరింగ్ కాలేజ్లో నా బీటెక్ పూర్తి చేయడం జరిగింది 2008-2012 బ్యాచ్ కంప్యూటర్ సైన్స్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ అండ్ ఆఫ్టర్ దాట్ నేను ఎంఎస్ కోసం యుఎస్ఏ వెళ్ళడం జరిగింది. అక్కడ టెక్సస్ ఏఎన్ఎం యూనివర్సిటీ కింగ్స్విల్లో మిస్ టెక్సస్ ఏఎన్ఎం యూనివర్సిటీ కింగ్స్విల్ 2014గా గెలవడం జరిగింది అండ్ ఐ వన్ ద ప్యాజన్. ఇట్స్ అ 95-year-old యూనివర్సిటీ బట్ ఇట్ హెస్ నెవర్ బీన్ వన్ బై ఎనీ ఇంటర్నేషనల్ స్టూడెంట్ ఎక్సెప్ట్ బై అమెరికన్స్. ఒక ఎన్జిఓకి ఫౌండర్గా, ఒక సోషల్ యాక్టివిస్ట్గా, ఒక మ్యాగజీన్కి ఎడిటర్గా, ఒక టైటిల్ విన్నర్గా, ఈ మెట్లన్నిటికీ కావాల్సిన ఫౌండేషన్ ఇక్కడ వాగ్దేవిలో పడింది అనడానికి నాకు ఐఎమ్ వెరీ హానరబుల్లీ సేయింగ్ దిస్ అండ్ ఐమ్ వెరీ ప్రౌడ్ టు సే దిస్. వాగ్దేవి ఇంజనీరింగ్ కాలేజ్ ఇట్స్ అన్ ఓపెన్ ప్లాట్ఫామ్ అండ్ అన్ ఓపెన్ ప్రాజెక్ట్ బికాస్ ప్రతి స్టూడెంట్ హెస్ బీన్ గివెన్ ఎనఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్ ఎనఫ్ అండ్ మోర్ దెన్ ఎనఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్ టు డూ వాట్ హీ వాంట్ టు డూ వాట్ హీ వాంట్ ఎక్స్ప్లోర్ టు డూ వాట్ హీ వాంట్ టు లర్న్.
Good morning to all of you. Am I audible? Am I audible to all? Kindly confirm.
Sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. Continue, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Good sure.
Morning. Yes.
Good morning.
Sir, take over the session.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So, dear participants, we are starting this session and kindly confirm, is it audible and visible to all of you?
Yes, sir, it is audible and visible also, sir.
Okay, so again, I have put this presentation in this format so that we can interact via messages. This session is dedicated to image data pre-processing techniques. How to pre-process the data, by which way we can transform our data set in multiple ways. We will see implementations. Each and every technique we will see with practical demonstration on Google Colab platform that is already integrated with TensorFlow, Keras, and OpenCV. First of all, we should be clear that there is need of image data preprocessing. Why do we need to transform our data set in different format, in different shape, in different structure, in a specific scenario? When we fetch any data set, whether it is from benchmark source or via a camera, for example, we are getting images from webcam, from CCTV, from DSLR cameras, then format associated with each and every camera is different. File structure is different. We can't process that data as it is in deep learning or machine learning or AI-based implementation. We must pre-process it. There is compulsion. It is mandatory to transform that data in a standardized way. It is also known as standardization or transformation in a processable format. Any data set which is taken vaguely by different cameras, by different CCTVs, webcams, it can't be put in deep learning or machine learning model as it is. So we will see which are different techniques of data preprocessing. And along with that, we will work on particular data set. First of all, we will take a particular data set, and that we will link in Python platform. First of all, I am opening my Google Drive. So I will show you how to link a data set from Google Drive to Google Colab, and then how to execute Python scripts directly on Google Drive data set. So for example, you are having a data set of animals, creatures, or faces. Those faces you can put in Google Drive because it will be permanent. And in that, with that particular data set, you can work with Python. So you can see that in my Google Drive, this is the folder animals. And in this, you can see that multiple classes of creatures are there. So these are different cheetah images. So these are different images related to animals. Okay, if I want to see this. In machine learning or in deep learning implementation, we can't use this data as it is, because each and every file is in a different shape, in a different structure, in different size. So it must be standardized, whether you are having face data. Okay, Leopard. So this folder I have uploaded in my Google Drive with multiple of images. Is it visible to all? Kindly confirm. Google Drive with folder of different images. Is this visible to all of you?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. Now we will see which type of operations we can perform on this particular data set. First of all, we should know how to link Google Drive with Google Colab. For example, here you are having data set of biometric fingerprints, faces, or creatures, or vehicles. Then how to collaborate it? So in I'm opening Google Colab to run Python scripts. So first of all, I will have to interface Google Colab. With this Google Drive. This process is known as mounting. We will have to mount Google Drive with our Python platform. Open Google Colab and you will see how mount. So each and every process I have mentioned in this presentation. So first of all, we take our data set, download our data in zip format from IEEE data board or from GitHub. Then we upload it on Google Drive. And after that, we mount it. We mount Google Drive. We link Google Drive with Google Colab. So you can see that for linking, for mounting, we have to follow a particular process. You can see this from google.colab, import drive and drive.mount. We have to mount it. Okay, so from google.colab, import drive. This is Google Drive. Okay, and after that, drive.mount. What is my drive path? This is content/content. In everybody's system, this is the path, /content and drive. First of all, we have to execute it. Connect. Okay, this process is given in this presentation also, which I will share to all of you. And now you can see that it is written that mounting Google Drive. What is meaning of that? Now this Google Drive, whatever data set is there, whatever files I am having in my Google Drive, I can link, I can import it here. Okay. Now what I will do, I will call images from my Google Drive, from my folders in Keras. So this is platform for machine learning, for deep learning, and we will see some implementations. First of all, we will see which particular implementation to start, how to work on different techniques. First of all, we must be clear which are different ways of data pre-processing. So this is the major problem, because images may be in different formats. For example, some file I am having in PNG format, some file I am having in JPG format. So you can see that some is written with JPEG extension, some is with JPG extension, some files are in 16x16, some files are in 32x32, some files are in TIFF format, some in BMP format. So we can't put this data directly in deep learning or machine learning model. Okay, so you will see that I'm opening these images first of all. And so this is one image, its size is different. And second image. So shape, size, structure, color combination of each and every image is different. And we have to process it before any particular implementation. Okay. So for example, this. So you can see that it is having different shape, different structure, different height and width. This image is having different height and width. So deep learning model can't process these images of multiple structures, multiple shapes directly. We have to process it. Okay, so now you can see that this, in same way, you can take face images, you can take biometric images, so its structure is different. Now first point is that what we can do to work on data pre-processing, which techniques are there? First technique is that it should be converted to grayscale image. in most of the implementations of data process of image data analytics or video data analytics, we work on grayscale conversion. First of all, we convert it to grayscale, any RGB image. Because in case of RGB image, what is major issue? In case of RGB image, there are multiple dimensions. It is multi-dimensional file. So to reduce the complexity of grayscale, to reduce the complexity of that RGB file, we go for grayscale so that its processing power can be improved. Its execution time can be improved. Otherwise, if we will process in RGB as it is, then it will take lots of time. There are so many variants of red, green, blue, different ranges are there. So to avoid that, first of all, we convert it to grayscale. Each and every image should be in grayscale, first point. Now, if I ask you one question, I'm asking you one question, reply in chat. In which cases grayscale conversion is not possible? Where, in which research problems we should not convert to grayscale? Because it is not a hard and fast rule. In which type of data sets we can't take grayscale implementation? Any idea? If you can write in chat. Because it is not a sure shot rule that each and every image must be in RGB to gray. In which scenarios this process will not be adopted? Any idea? Kindly write in chat. Where we should not use RGB to grayscale conversion. So I request participants to respond, to contribute in queries, so that it will be an interactive session, and during the session we can take queries also. No idea. Okay. If you don't know, then you can write no idea or don't know, no problem. Major point is that we should be in communication. Okay. If we are working on some applications like medical images, then we should not go for grayscale. If we are working for healthcare diagnosis, for autonomous vehicles, for agriculture, if we are having a data set of agriculture, then we should not go for grayscale conversion. Otherwise, what will happen? Some crop color, some particular color combination of a particular vegetable, fruit, or any crop, it will not be identified. It will not be recognized. If we are working on traffic lights, if we are working on space analytics, space exploration, okay? So space explorations. In that case, we should not use grayscale conversion, because grayscale conversion will not be appropriate for that. We have to identify each and every object with its actual color. In grayscale, its color will be reformed, its color will be changed. In healthcare also, for example, we are having MRI image, CT scan image, it must be in colored image. It should be processed in colored. Otherwise, for example, there is some abnormal cell, there is some abnormal point in somebody's MRI or X-ray or CT scan, it will not be identified. Is this point clear to all of you? In which scenarios it is impractical to use grayscale? Is this clear to all? Kindly confirm. Okay, now we will see first point, how to go for grayscale conversion in Python. Beyond grayscale, we can use normalization, data augmentation. We will cover it also. Data augmentation, data standardization. Okay, so grayscale conversion, you can see this. For grayscale conversion, we are having a specialized package in Python that is SK image. You can see that this SK image, SK image dot color dot RGB to gray, whatever image we have read, whatever image we are having. So we are checking it here. So first of all, we have linked our Google Drive here. It will fetch images from my Google Drive. And this is my path. You can see that this path I have mentioned in content drive, my drive animals. So this is same path in content. Content and drive is common for everybody. In that animals. Okay. And which are class names? These are the class names. Class name means these folder names I have mentioned. For example, you are working in face analytics, in biometric, in fingerprint. So you can put employee ID or person's name or Aadhaar ID, whatever it is, by which way you can uniquely identify that specific person. Okay. Class names, these. And after that, we can convert it. So this is the actual image. First of all, we'll see its actual image. Okay. After presenting to actual image, then we will see. So first of all, it is in RGB. After that, we want to convert it to grayscale. So you can see this. Import SK image. And with only this line, SK image dot color dot gray. Okay, SK image dot color dot RGB to grayscale. Okay, if you want to convert it to multiple channels, to multiple RGB channels, then we can use it. Okay, otherwise we can directly use IM show. Okay, grayscale image and then IM show. In this way, this particular image will be converted. So currently it is fetching data from Google Drive, and at final level it is converted to grayscale. When a particular deep learning model or machine learning model to be used, then only this image should be processed. Only this image should be given to our model. If we try to give this actual image, RGB image, in that case, that model will not be fit properly. Okay. So this is first point, RGB to gray conversion, very simple. So first of all, we have imported this image. So if I want to remove anything, so for example, so we can put a comment also. So this is a comment. Only two lines we want to use. So you can see this. So other image channels we have put in comments. Now only RGB to gray. So in with only these two lines, import SK image. SK image is a package of Python for image data processing, for image based machine learning. We can attach SK image with scikit-learn also. Okay, if I delete these comments, then all color variants will be visible. Okay, now second point. So this code snippet I have given here, it is given in this presentation also, so you can directly copy it. Okay, so here what we do, simply import SK image. And this is the output. So directly we use this function. Now, this point we have already discussed, that grayscale conversion is not suitable for everything. If you are working in traffic light, for space exploration, for DRDO, for agriculture, for crops, then we can't use grayscale. We should not use grayscale. Okay. Now we'll see another point that is also comes under image data processing. This is related to image normalization and scaling. What is meaning of image normalization and scaling? You might have seen that when I have opened these images, each and every image is in different size. Each and every image is having its own properties. Okay, something, some particular image is in 10 by 10, some image is in 20 by 20 or 20 by 40. So this is one image, okay, and this image. So it is having a different structure, different shape. So it is not acceptable by any algorithm. We can't use different variants of images in neural network. We have to standardize it for better accuracy. For that, what we do? We have to confine, we have to define a unique structure. We have to define a uniform structure of each and every image. All of those images should be in normal distribution, should be in a specific range. I'm asking you one question, okay? By this way, it will be more clear, okay? For example, I'm having a particular data set of CSV data, okay? Not for images, because it will be more clear with that. For example, I'm having a data in which age is given and age, BP level, and some particular factor like weight. For example, some age is 20, BP level is 180, whatever it is, okay, and 89. For example, this data. We are understanding the concept of normalization. Why do we use normalization in every case, whether it is image or it is data, it is text data, like this, okay, and weight is this. If I do not use normalization on this data set also, then what will happen? BP level will dominate the entire prediction. Why BP level will dominate the entire prediction? It means maximum predictions will be done on the basis of BP level only. Why? Can anybody give a reason? If we do not use normalization on this data, then why BP level will dominate the prediction level? Every prediction will be done only on the basis of this particular parameter. Any random guess? Yes, definitely. Because value range is high. Because computer don't know, algorithm don't know what is BP level. Algorithm don't know what is weight. It is only an attribute. So it is having min max. So min max range decides the dominating factor. So maximum prediction will be done by BP level, after that weight. But it should not be used in machine learning or deep learning. We have to standardize it. We have to normalize it. Every value should be in 0 and 1. So using normalization techniques, we normalize it. Okay, 20 should be converted to 0.9. It should be converted to range between 0 and 1 or minus 1 to 1. Same thing happens in images. If a particular image is taken using DSLR camera, using 20 megapixel camera, that will dominate the prediction on that camera image, which is taken by 2 megapixel camera. If some samples are taken from 100 megapixel camera and some samples are taken from 5 megapixel camera, then 5 megapixel camera images will be not contributing. These will not be contribute in prediction. Is this clear to all of you? Are you getting this point? Why normalization is required? Whether you have taken images from 100 megapixel camera or 2 megapixel camera or VGA camera, it should be in standard way. All images must be standardized. This is known as data rescaling. And for that, you can see this is this code snippet. So min max, this is minimum value and maximum value. So we confine it in a specific range. Whether some image is taken from high resolution camera, it must be normalized. Okay, so you can see this in this way. So whatever image we are getting, now all images will be in this format. all images will have same color combination. All images will have same color band. Okay, rather than different bands, different bandwidths, different resolution for every image. Rather than that, we should take care of normalization factor. So I will give this notepad, this particular code file also. So I will download this file and I will give it to you. Download ITYNB. Okay. I will share it at end of this session. Okay. Is this point clear to all of you? What is meaning of normalization and why it is mandatory? So in min-max, so from entire data set, we check what is the maximum value from 100 megapixel camera and minimum value from VGA camera, from 2 megapixel camera. Then we normalize all images. We perform averaging. This is known also associated with averaging concept. Is it clear to all? Averaging, okay, or normalization, which we can use. Now another point, another technique, rather than simply normalization and rescaling and grayscale. This is very, very popular technique and most of the researchers use data augmentation. Many times we are not having sufficient data. Using data augmentation techniques, we increase the data set. For example, I'm having fingerprint images. I'm having only 50 images. In only 50 images, my prediction will be not good. If I'm working on face recognition, in face recognition, I'm having only 10 faces, only 20 faces I have collected. For example, I'm having MRI images or CT scan images, but I'm having only 20 CT scan. What I will do with 20 CT scan images? Machine learning or deep learning will not run on 20 CT scan images. If it will run, prediction will be very, very bad. Okay. So to increase the data set, for example, you are working in agriculture domain. You have taken snaps of some crops. You are having 20-30 photographs. So 20-30 photographs are not sufficient for deep learning or neural network. We need 200 images. You need 2000 images. From where you will get 2000 images of a crop? To increase the data set, we perform augmentation. Augmentation means, for example, you are having 50 images. Those 50 images will be converted to 1000 images. If you are having 100 fingerprints, those 100 fingerprints can be converted to 1 lakh fingerprints using data augmentation. Are you getting what I mean to say, what I'm telling? What is the role of data augmentation? Increasing data set. If you are having only 5 images, only 5 videos, I can convert 5 videos to 500 videos using data augmentation. How it is possible? How it is technically possible to convert 5 images to 500 images? By cropping, by rotation. So one image in actual format, second image in 20 degree left, then 25 degree left, then 30 degree left, then in anti-clockwise, in clockwise. So multiple variants of same image, so that my data set will be sufficient for training. Okay. So if we are using, if you are having a small data set, then we use offline augmentation. For real time data set, for real time images like webcam, traffic light, we use online augmentation. Okay. And in Keras, there is a particular package, image data generator, for data augmentation. So image data generator package is used in Keras. in Python Keras. So you can see that this is the actual image. So from actual image, one image is one subset is taken by shearing by this angle, from this angle, from this angle. It means from single image, three different images are created. For example, I'm having this image. Okay, for example, this is the image, any image we can take. This is first image. Okay, now I want to perform augmentation. So MS Paint I'm opening just for description. So now I'm doing manually, but actually it is done automated way in Keras. It is done automatically. This is first data. So I'm performing shearing. This is second in this way, one from this angle. So from single image, I have created so many subsamples, so many images. So I will save each and every file in a separate JPG format, in separate JPG file. Okay. Image is the same, but using rotation, using shearing, using cropping, we are creating. So this is manual process, but in Keras, in Python, it is done automatically using that particular package. Okay, using specific package. So I'm putting this also in my presentation so that I can share it to you. Okay, in this way, same image, but from single image, five images are generated. This is known as data augmentation. From one image, we are taking multiple angles, multiple rotations. So shifting image pixels horizontally and vertically. Okay, because from a location, you have taken a sample from your camera. So for example, you can't move to that location again and again. That is very sensitive location. So from same data set, you can create different subsamples. Okay, so in this way. And this is the code snippet. So you can see that this package we have used here from Keras, from Python Keras, import image data generator. And what we will do, shifting. So this hash shifting, and how much width, how many pixels we want to shift. So in image data generator, we want to shift 200 pixels. 200 pixels clockwise and anti-clockwise, and then we perform it. Okay, so if when we will run it, it will be generated in this way. So single image is converted to three images, first, second, third. If I want to use this, what is my range? So -500, 500. Then you will see a different orientation, different images will be generated. Now you can see that it is out of that image. So 100, 100. But we are having multiple samples. Okay, so you can see this. We can check at which, in which particular way we are getting the actual images. So you can see this. Okay, so from single image, we can create multiple variants. Is this clear to all of you? How to use data shifting? Now you can see that this part is taken. Is this clear to all participants? How to increase the data set if we are not having sufficient data? Is it clear to all? Now flipping based data, flipping. So same data, flipping based data augmentation, one in 180 degree direction, one in minus 90 degree direction, third image in 45 degree direction. So same data. In this way, we can increase our data set to any size, to 1000 times. 50 images will be converted to 500 images, 5000 images, because many times in research work we need sufficient number of images. For that we use data augmentation. So you can see this flipping. So one image in this way, second image in this format, third image in this format. From one image, we have created three different images using image data generator. Horizontal flip true, vertical flip true. Which technique you want to flip? We want to flip it horizontally as well as vertically, and then its size will be increased. For example, we are having 100 images. From 100 images, using flipping only, we can generate 300 images. Okay, so very powerful technique and very, very prominently used approach for data augmentation, that which we can use for our research and development. For example, you have taken some camera images, then you can use it. Is this clear to all of you up to this point, whatever we have covered? Is it clear to all? So this is flipping based data augmentation, and it works for every scenario, whether you are working on face biometric, face recognition, fingerprints, geospatial data, Google Map, OpenStreetMap. In every scenario, it will be workable. Okay, now rotation based. So same, so one at 20 degree rotation. So you can see that in multiple rotations. So 20 degree rotation, then 25 degree rotation, then 40 degree rotation. So same data set will be rotated on multiple directions. And after that, we can generate its multiple samples. Is this clear to all of you? Rotation based augmentation. So each and everything is done via image data generator. Very powerful technique. Rotation, or you can work on changing brightness. So using this line, this image data generator is part of Keras platform. So for data pre-processing, we use Keras. So you can see that this, all of these code snippets. So changing brightness. So one image in this high brightness, second is in low brightness, then in intermediate brightness level. Okay, and beyond this, we can use cropping. A particular part can be cropped. Okay, well, I'm creating its PDF file so that I can share it to you, all of you. Up to this point, is it clear to all of you? Kindly confirm. And how much it is looking easy or difficult to work with? So it's file I have created, and at end of this session I will share. Now we will see the implementations related to video and integrated images. How to use real world camera, real time camera images and shots. For this implementation, we will use a Python based library, very powerful library, that is OpenCV, free and open source library, Python based platform for computer vision based applications. So many research projects can be done using OpenCV. Free and open source. Its interfaces are available for Python also, for Java, PHP, .NET, MATLAB, Scilab, GNU Octave. for multiple programming platforms, its interface is available, its APIs are available. How many of you are aware with OpenCV? Yes or no? Kindly write in chat. How many of you are aware with OpenCV based implementations for image analytics and video processing? Okay, so this is the official website of OpenCV. So we will see it's some very powerful, some very attractive implementations related to Open Computer Vision. It is freely available in free and open source distribution. So this is the library. You can work on image forensics, on document forgery detection, on image data analytics, image data processing. So you can see this. OpenCV and so many corporate giants are using OpenCV library for artificial intelligence and machine learning as well as deep learning. So AI-based models are available here. For video analytics, you can see this. And these are available in free distribution. So I will show you some implementations here related to OpenCV. Okay. If you are working on some research project, then you can use OpenCV. We can write source code of OpenCV in Raspberry Pi, in Arduino for object detection, object analytics. Okay. OpenCV. So vehicle detection. So vehicle detection from video, from images, object detection, facial landmark detection, all of these we can work. Now we will see, we will start with very basic implementation of image data analytics. And those images we will capture from webcam. Actually, whenever we capture something from webcam, it is a video. But at the back end of video, there are images. What is a video? Video is a sequence of images. Video is a sequence of frames. Each and every frame is an image. So we will see how to work on feature extraction. Feature extraction in images. In images, this is also very important point, a very important concept in image data analytics. By which way a particular person can be identified uniquely? By which way an object can be identified uniquely? For example, I'm working on some object identification like apple, pomegranate, and some banana. So obviously banana is having a particular shape. Coconut is having a particular shape. So that we call as edge or corners. So we can train the corners of object, train the corners of different vegetables or fruits. Is it correct or not? Can we train edges and corners of objects? Because all apples, all fruits are having its unique shape. Okay, if we want to classify between vehicles, so bicycle is having a unique shape. So edge detection, corner detection techniques we can use. Are you getting this point? We will see its implementation in OpenCV. All of you are you getting these points? Kindly confirm. By edge detection, by corner detection, we can identify any person, any object. Now, I'm opening OpenCV code snippets. And you can see that in 5 to 6 lines of code, if I remove empty lines, then you can see that this Edge webcam. So what is CV2? CV2 is OpenCV. CV2.videocapture. You can see that how much it is easy. CV2.videocapture. Zero means my camera. Whatever camera is attached with my system. If I'm having so many cameras and I want to get videos and images and those edges, those corners from fourth camera, I will write 3. Starting from 0, I want to capture images and corners from fourth camera. I want to capture from ninth camera, 8. From first camera, 0. After that, frames will be read, cap.read. Whatever is captured, it is converted to grayscale. And you can see this is the algorithm, Kenny edge detection. In whatever video we want to extract images and their features, we can implement direct algorithms, Kenny edge detection, Shi-Tomasi algorithm, random forest approach. Thousands of algorithms are already available with OpenCV. Now I'm running this code in my system and you will see its output. In 5 to 6 lines of code, how to work on OpenCV based implementations. So I am sitting in front of the camera and you will see, is it visible to all of you? Are you able to see these features? So I'm sitting in front of the camera and my edges, my corners. So whatever is there behind me, its corners are identified. Okay, so you can see there. Is this visible to all of you? Image data extraction with edges. Okay, if I want to see this in some particular algorithm, some colored approach, so Harris Corner algorithm. So this you can see Harris webcam. So all of these algorithms for image data analysis are already available. So Harris Corner, no need to write complete code of Harris Corner algorithm, simply call its function. Okay, Python Harris webcam, and whosoever is sitting in front of the camera. So you can see this. This is my video. Is it visible to all of you? And at backend, you can see my features are getting recorded. In Excel sheet, we can save it. So if I will move my location, then my edges will be extracted. So whatever is there with me, so you can see this. Even hand edges are also there with OpenCV. So in a neural network, in deep learning model, I can train this data. This data is about my edges. And if I want to see its source code in 10 to 15 lines of code, so CV2.videocapture. From video capture, we are getting images, and in those images, we are implementing this algorithm directly. And we can see its documentation on OpenCV. OpenCV, Corner Harris, if I want to see its source code. So it will be visible here. I'm opening its link. So this is Harris Corner detection. Its mathematical model is also given, and by which way it will identify the corners. So what I have done in this code, I have changed only this line. Here I have written CV2 dot video capture rather than a still image. So all source codes will be available on OpenCV platform, very popular platform for computer vision for artificial intelligence. So you can see that in multiple programming languages, you will get its source code. If you want to work with C++, simply take this code. Okay. And it will give you preview also. If you will apply this image, then what will be the output? This type of output. Same type of output you have seen in my video. So this source code in 7 to 8 lines of code, you will be able to work. Feature extraction. Same thing you can implement with mobile cam videos also. If some camera is there with our mobile, we can link that camera also. So when we work in image data analytics, image processing, then edge detection algorithms, SIFT algorithm, SURF algorithm, we have to use so that we can identify something. If you want to perform same thing on still images, for example, this rather than using CV2 dot video capture, I want to use a particular image. So this is person.jpg. For example, I'm having some X-ray image. This is X-ray. On this image, I want to use Harris corner edge detection. So rather than CV2 dot video capture, I will use X-ray. And now Python Harris corner. So you can see this. Edges are identified. On whatever image. Okay. By this way, and if I want to print it, if I want to print all of these values, we can print. Simply use print function and you can do it. If you want to perform on real-time video, it can be done. Okay, and in very less lines of code, we will be able to work with it. So in this particular code snippet, we have used video capture. Okay. Same thing if you want to subtract background. Okay. For example, this is some video. This is some particular video. I want to subtract background. So subtract background. Direct functions are available. CV2 dot video capture. Here I will use that file name .avi. And now I will see Python subtract background. Inbuilt functions are available. So background image is subtracted. Are you able to view this? So from any running video, we want to separate some part. It can be done. If I want to perform same thing on video, on running video, video capture 0. Now it will be implemented in camera. I am sitting in front of the camera, so on me it will be implemented. So whatsoever is moving, only that particular video will be separate, will be viewed. Or you can work it with pedestrian. That, okay. So it will be on a real-time video. Okay, so all of these points come under image data evaluation from video also. So image data doesn't mean that only we will take JPG images, or we should take only a particular TIFF image or BMP image. We can fetch images, we can fetch prints, fingerprints from videos also. And you can see that for that, direct functions are available. Create background subtractor emoji. This is by default. Okay. Direct functions are available. No need to write scripts, no need to write code. It is completely free and open source. CV2.create background subtractor. In single line, it will be implemented. Okay. Is it looking difficult? How much it is looking easy or difficult? Please reply in chat. How much it is looking easy, difficult, effective for research? So for example, you are working in some implementation for some research project. We are working for law enforcement agencies. So we can use such parts. For example, some guided missile, some weapons are deployed in border area. So we can see which particular object is moving, whether that particular, whether some particular movements are allowed or not in international border. So in that particular case, we can see which thing is moving. What is the moving part? If there is some movement of suspect, then automatically that weapon should be activated. In same way, we can work on some object analytic patterns. Up to this, is it clear to all of you? And how much it is looking easy or difficult working with OpenCV? In chat, kindly respond. How much it is looking easy or difficult to work with? How much it is looking effective or usable for you? So many times we apply for some funded projects, some research projects, funded projects from AICTE, from DST, from MITI. So we can propose very good projects. OpenCV can be installed in Raspberry Pi. It can be installed in Arduino board. It can be installed in Google BeagleBone. For example, we are developing a particular application for traffic light, for number plate detection. It can be done. So webcam will be capturing number plate, and using OCR techniques and inbuilt functions of OpenCV, we can read that number plate, which digits are there, which characters are there. Okay, so all implementations are available. OpenCV, number plate detection, all of these are already available. So you can see this automated licenses. And if we want to recognize some particular object, we can do it. Okay. In parallel to that, there are certain platforms like Loeb, loeb.ai. It is also available in free distribution for image recognition. So you can see that. Hand gestures recognition. Okay, whether somebody is with mask or without mask, loeb.ai. So all of these platforms are available for multiple domains. Okay, whether it is for agriculture or even for fire monitoring, we can check, okay, how much smoke is there. Fire watch. In production units. Okay, space exploration, deforestation. Okay. Train your app with Loeb. Okay, we can directly integrate it. And in OpenCV, For example, you want to work on forgery analysis, okay, image forgery, or plan feature. For example, plan matcher. I'm showing you that part. Okay. In image, we want to process. We want to identify some object. So you can see this source code is available in C++, in Java, in Python, in whatever language you are comfortable, you can take the code, open source, C++ code. If I'm comfortable in Eclipse, Java, NetBeans, this Java code is available. If I want to work with Python, then Python code. And you can see that we can easily identify which particular part, which particular component is matching with some other object. So for image analytics, for image processing, for image forgery detection, we can do it. For example, you want to match two signatures, whether these two signatures are matching or not. So you can use this technique of OpenCV. If you want to match two faces, which pixels are matching, we can adopt this platform. Okay. Even for videos also, if I want to run it in video, so we can use CV2.video capture. Then it will be working. So in real time running videos, we want to identify some object. We want to match some object. It can be done. Okay, so for example, we want to identify some motion, some movement. So for example, this check, okay, this is first check. Second, we want to identify whether these two signatures are matching or not. Whether these signatures are copied and pasted or by handwritten, like this. So these two signatures are matching, but we can check forgery, whether it is taken by printout or it is done by hands. Because nowadays in clearinghouse, scanned checks are sent. So using OpenCV image analytics, we can check whether these two signatures are matching or not, whether these two signatures are done by hands manually or it is done via printout. So in this way, so if you will execute this code in Python, in Java, so you can see that so many algorithms are available here. Shift, surf. Okay, shift, surf, feature points, analytics, feature point cleaning also. If you want to clean the data set, so at backend of OpenCV, so many image pre-processing algorithms are available by which way we can clean it. If we are having some blurred images, those blurred images can be cleaned using OpenCV. Okay, and this OpenCV BF matcher. So brute force matcher in this way. So if you are new in this particular domain, in Python, in image analytics, you can work on comparative evaluation of different techniques. So one implementation you can do with FLAN feature detection. Second implementation, you can move with BF matcher. Then we can compare the results, which is faster, which is giving better accuracy. Okay, so brute force matching with shift descriptors, source code. Simply take this source code and you can directly apply it. FLAN feature matcher. How many pixels are matching? So for document analytics, for feature points evaluation, for data pre-processing, this is very powerful platform, OpenCV. Is it visible to all of you? Source code along with its given output. Are you able to view?
Yes, sir.
Are you getting all of these? Kindly write in chat. Different algorithms, pre-trained algorithms, pre-trained models. Is it visible to all? Kindly confirm. Are you understanding these points? How to use Python computer vision platform for image data processing, image data analytics. On video, we use video capture zero. And so you can see this image thresholding, smoothing of images. If you want to smooth it, morphological transformations. So all of these operations are available by default for image data analytics, 2D convolutional. Okay, so if you want to process this image, so simply copy this code snippet, run in Python, averaging. So for example, you want to convert original image to blurred image or blurred to original image. Which Gaussian operation, which particular filtering technique we want to apply. So you can see this. So in very less lines of code, we can work with very powerful implementations. So you can see this is the actual image. From actual image, we can generate multiple images. All source codes given. So as you have seen, some implementations we have seen in dynamic videos, in real-time video analytics. How much it is looking effective for your work? Kindly confirm, kindly write in chat. In minimum lines of code, how to work on OpenCV based implementations. Are you getting all of these points? And we write in chat how much it is looking usable for your work. How much it is looking effective for your implementations related to computer vision. Okay. So Harris webcam, or if I want to use this, so for blurring, we can use, okay, CV2.video capture. Whatever video will be there, blurring operation will be implemented. Is it clear to all of you? Up to now, kindly confirm. Kindly write in chat. Is it clear to all how to work on different implementations of OpenCV? And in geometrical transformations, GUI features. Mouse is a paintbrush. So multiple scenarios we can work with this platform. I'm taking some scripts so that I can give it to you. All of these code snippets I'm sharing. So its presentation is also with me. So in OpenCV, so which are different applications. So these are different applications related to OpenCV. For example, you want to work on swarm drones. Or for military applications, we can use OpenCV, okay, or object detection. Automatically, OpenCV will identify what is this particular object. So you can see this. For object detection, for military applications, for swarm drones with military-based applications, law enforcement agencies, you can work. Agriculture domain-based agri-bots, you can work. Okay. So all of these applications, we can work with OpenCV. Multiple platforms are compatible. So all of these screen, these code snippets and files I'm sharing to all of you. If you have any query, you can ask any query from participants. Any query from participants. Meanwhile, I am uploading all of these study materials, presentations, and source codes. I will share its link on cloud. Any query from participants, kindly ask. If you have any doubt, anything, any point of discussion. So this file, these files will remain for 6 days on cloud, and I am creating its link. So I am uploading this complete data set and these presentations. So dear participants, link of the study material I have shared in chat. Please click on this link and download all of these files. And kindly confirm, are you able to download it or not? Whether it is downloadable or not. Kindly confirm whether you are able to download these presentations or not. If you have any query, you can ask. After that, we will have a break. Any query from participants, anything, any point of discussion? House is open for discussions. So if there is no query, should we break?
Yes, participants, any queries, please? If there are no queries, we'll take a break, lunch break, and we'll start the next session at 2 p.m.
Okay, so thank you to all of you.
Thank you, sir. We'll meet at 2 p.m., sir.
Yes. Thank you.